हेलो हेलो एवरीवन, कैन यू हियर मी? कविता,
यस मैम, क्लियरली प्लीज।
या सो हेलो, वेलकम एवरीवन टू दिस वेबिनार ऑन मेजरमेंट ऑफ अनसर्टेनिटी इन फूड केमिकल टेस्टिंग। जस्ट यस्टरडे वी एक्सपीरियंस द अनसर्टेनिटी ऑफ इवेंट। ओके, दिस वेबिनार हैड टू बी पोस्टपोन्ड due to some technical errors, and we've now fixed those technical errors, and here we are again today attending the webinar, but today with certainty. And that's why I've added a small blue color wordings. You can see that it's with certainty today, hopefully. Yeah, so jokes apart, but now let us move on to the presentation. And one second. Yeah, now I'm sure you are all sitting in front of your laptops or in front of your desktops and you're viewing the screen. Now, just to make you understand what is uncertainty in a very, very simple terms, is that if I ask you that you have to measure the length of your laptop or the length of your desktop, okay, and let us assume that you measure it as 20 centimeters, okay, can you say with absolute certainty that the length is 20 centimeters? No, you cannot. Okay, because there are some other aspects that you need to consider. Firstly, the sensitivity of the scale that you are using. Okay, the scale that is available at home may not be calibrated. Okay, it may not be the most sensitive device to measure a length of the measure the length of the laptop. And also, you are not sure about the edge of the laptop. Okay, that exactly matches the mark on the scale. So you are not sure whether the length is exactly 20 centimeters. Okay, but if you can say that the length is not more than plus minus 2 centimeters different than your measurement, okay, then this plus minus 2 centimeters is the deviation in the measurement, okay, which in scientific terms, scientific language parlance, is called as uncertainty. Okay, so Kavita, just give me a moment. I cannot see my screen because of this window popping up here. One second. Yeah. So now, yeah. So this plus minus 2 centimeters is the deviation in the measurement, and that exactly is the uncertainty. Okay. This is in a very simple language. So in short, the laptop is no longer than 22 centimeters and no shorter than 18 centimeters. So this 18 centimeters to 22 centimeters is actually the confidence interval and the skill, okay, of a chemist or the analyst is to get a small confidence interval. Now, if this experiment is repeated 100 times, 95 times, or even 99 times, okay, the result of the measurement would be in the above range, and this is known as confidence level. So the confidence level generally in the chemical testing that we use is generally 95%. Okay, so this is the confidence level uncertainty in technical language, okay, but it is still easy to understand. Now, why it won't move? One sec. Okay, yeah, now you're convinced. Okay, oh, rather I have convinced you that the length of your laptop is now somewhere between 18 centimeters and 22 centimeters, but funny enough, you still do not know the true value of the length of the laptop, because the true value is an absolute value and you cannot determine it correctly. Okay, so it is like you know that there is God, okay, but you cannot actually see the God. Okay, you just try to get close to God. Okay, so it is very similar to that kind of a analogy. Okay, so this uncertainty is nothing but doubt. It is nothing concerned to doubt. It is just about deviation. Okay, so however you try, okay, your aim should be to go as close to the true value as possible. Okay, now let us see the definition, technical definition of uncertainty. So a parameter associated with the result of a measurement that characterizes the dispersion of the values that could reasonably be attributed to the measurement. Uncertainty, therefore, is a parameter to express variation in the result or variation in the data, like we said, plus minus 2 centimeters. Okay, so uncertainty in science does not imply doubt as it does. It just means deviation. Okay, and you are sure about that deviation. That is more important. Let us briefly see the history. The origin of uncertainty actually lies in quantum mechanics. And there was this physicist, Heisenberg, who actually was working on uncertainties of particle positions and momentum. So he showed that uncertainties would always be there if you try to measure the position and momentum of a particle at the same time. And he actually published this work in a paper called Uncertainty Principle in 1927. So the origin of uncertainty goes back to 1927. Okay. Now let us quickly see what are the today's objectives. Before we actually begin the understanding of uncertainty, there are a few concepts that I want you all to understand. These are basically concepts of error, precision, accuracy, and data distribution. Okay. Then after that, we will move to uncertainty sources. Various terms which are used in uncertainty measurement, then calculations, then reporting results, decision rule, and question answers if time permits. Now let us quickly see what is error. Okay. Now weight of a person on a bathroom scale, let us assume that it is 66. We have bathroom scales in our houses, right? So it is 66 kgs. Now weight of the same person on an electronic balance turns out to be 65 kg. Now let us assume in this case that since it's an electronic balance, it is more accurate and the value given by that balance is a true value. So 65 kg becomes the true value. Okay. Now the difference between the measured value, which is 66, okay, and the true value, which is 65, this is known as error. This is not uncertainty. Okay. This is error. And this error is of plus 1 kg. So what you have to understand about the error is that errors can be controlled. Okay, and they can be characterized. Okay, so also in principle, since now you know that there is an error of plus 1 kg, you can actually apply it to the result and do a correction. Okay, so every time you weigh on a bathroom scale, okay, and if it is 66, you will say it actually it is 65. So what you are doing is you are actually applying that error to your result, but that cannot be done with uncertainty, remember. Okay, so and also error is a single value, uncertainty is always expressed in range. Okay, like we said, plus minus 2 centimeters, that's the range. Okay, whereas error is a single value. So like we have a positive error, we can also have a negative error. Okay, so there are three types of errors: systematic, random, and gross. Gross error we are not considering here because that amounts to outliers. Okay, and therefore we will not consider here, but we will certainly quickly go through systematic errors and random errors. Systematic errors basically could be because of various reasons, but I have just example I have given of three errors. Instrumental error, basically this is because of faulty calibration, like you're using electronic equipment or you are using glassware which is not calibrated. These will all introduce the instrumental errors. Then there are method errors, like for example a method, okay, which is based on a slow or incomplete reaction, or the method that is measuring a moiety which is not stable, okay, and you are supposed to actually take the reading within 10 minutes, but because of some reason you have not taken in 10 minutes, things like that. So that will all amount to method error. Okay, then there are interferences in the method, in the methods. So if you do not fix those interferences, your result will be affected and error will be introduced. These are method errors. Okay, then there are personal errors. Okay, we are all human beings. Okay, sometimes we are tired, we are inattentive, okay, or we have certain personal limitations. Then there are some personal judgments to be made, like the end point of the titration. Some people find it difficult to correctly know what is the end point. So these are all personal errors, and these will also amount to finally to the uncertainty. Okay, so if you see this graph, what it is telling you is the blue curve. Okay, the blue curve is the normal or the ideal scenario. Okay, when there is no error. Okay, although it cannot exist, but it is still just for understanding purpose. So the blue curve, okay, shifts to the left hand side. Okay, because of systematic error. Okay, it can also shift to a right hand side. Okay, so what is happening is that the average, okay, the tip of the blue curve, okay, is shifting to left, or it can also shift to right. So you are actually introducing a plus or minus error, okay, which is called as a bias in this case. Okay, so systematic error will actually change the average, okay, to plus or minus side. Now comes the random error. Random error, as the name suggests, it is always present. Okay, and it could be because of fluctuating experimental conditions like temperature, humidity, okay, changes in the voltages. The next could be the next factor which gives you random errors is human errors. Okay, like for example, if your personnel is not trained properly, they do not know how to pipette out, use a micro pipette, or how to see the minuscule levels, or how to read a volume. You know, there could be errors because of humans. So that is human error. Then disturbance to measuring equipment. Okay, for example, imagine a situation wherein a balance and a centrifuge. Okay, they are kept on the same bench, but when the centrifuge is running. If you take a reading on the balance, that time only the readings will be affected. But in other cases, there will be no error introduced. So these are all random errors, okay? And they will always be present. So now if you see the same graph again, the blue ideal scenario, okay? The average of that blue scenario is not changing. You can just see that the dispersion of the results has increased. So a lot of results, okay, around the mean you can see. So this random error actually does not affect the average. It is only introducing variability around the average. Now, how do we minimize? Can we minimize? Yes, we can minimize, okay, especially the systematic errors. We can actually minimize the systematic errors by careful calibration and calibration checks of your equipment instruments, then using the best possible methods and equipment and manpower as well, keeping your trainings on continuously, you can decrease the systematic errors. But as far as the random errors are concerned, since they are random, you cannot actually fix them. They will be always there. So the only answer to reduce the random errors is to have repeated measurements, like we did in the first case. Okay. Yeah. This is another concept. A lot of people find it difficult really to understand precision and accuracy. Just see this experiment that the aim here is to hit the bullseye, okay, the innermost circle. Okay, now if you see the extreme right figure, the aim is really really poor. Okay, it is nowhere near the bullseye. Okay, and all the four measurements that are there, they're also haywire. Now the next figure, somehow we are close to the bullseye, but the readings are far away from each other. The next figure, the readings are very very close to each other, but then they are nowhere near the bullseye. And the last figure on the extreme left, you can actually see that we've hit the bullseye and all the readings are very, very close to each other. So precision is about repeatability of measurement. Okay, how close your results are. Closer they are, the better, the more precision. Okay, and accuracy is actually closeness to the true value. So in this case, the true value is nothing but to hit the bullseye. Okay, so this is accuracy and precision for you. Now comes a little tricky part, I would say, distribution functions. A lot of people get confused when it comes to distribution functions, but they're really simple to understand. Basically, what we are trying to do with distribution functions is to actually segregate your data, to process your data. Now we say that we take a lot of readings and we generate data. Now, if you do not process that data, it is of no use, okay? So distribution functions tell us how is the data distributed. They tell us the relationship between the outcome of an event and its frequency of occurrence. Now, when you know how your measurement function has performed in the past, you can more appropriately analyze it and predict future outcomes. So for all these purposes, statistics actually uses distribution functions. Now, as far as the chemical tests are concerned, we are concerned only with these three type of distributions: normal distribution, rectangular distribution, and triangular distribution. Normal distribution is the distribution which is very evident when you take multiple measurements, okay, repeated observations. So normal distribution is used when an estimate is made from repeated observations. This is what we keep doing in the lab. We all are chemists and we perform experiments multiple times and we generate data, okay. So we perform experiments in triplicates, okay, in five triplicates. So the data that we generate by this method, repeated observations, okay, is actually a normal distribution data. It's a function of normal distribution. Okay, this is one example. So this is about chloride analysis, and there are a lot of people doing this analysis. You can see that if you plot on the x-axis the concentration of chloride in ppm versus the frequency, so a lot of people have often different results, and we have just put them in different slots. So you can see that 15 chemists have obtained the concentration in the range of 400 to 500 ppm. And you can see the graph there on the right hand side, and you can see the peak there. Okay, you can see that almost 15 You can see on the y-axis it is 15, corresponding to 15, and on the x-axis it is somewhere between 450. So the average of this result, okay, this entire repeated observations turns out to be between 400 and 500, which is nothing but the average. Okay, so all our experiments that we perform in the lab, chemical experiments, I'm not talking about microbiological experiments here. The chemical experiments that we perform day to day in our labs, they all are following normal distribution. Okay, so you get a good bell-shaped curve. Okay, this is the normal distribution explained in a more technical way. The pink area that you can see, okay, what is that? I'll explain to you. You can first see mu, which is the central line. Okay, that's the mean or the average, and it is denoted as mu. You can see that mu there. Okay, and you can also see there on the right hand side it is mu plus sigma. On the left hand side it is mu minus sigma. What is this sigma? This is nothing but standard deviation. So when we just did this chloride experiment, we found out various results. So now if you want to find out the standard deviation, we'll just put all the values in the Excel and just put is equal to sign and just say standard deviation, and Excel will give you standard deviation. It is as simple as that. But when you just say one standard deviation and plus minus one standard deviation, you can see that the pink area, okay, it just contributes to about 68%. Okay, it means that a lot of your results, okay, so 100 minus 68% of the results are lying outside this plus minus one sigma, outside this plus minus one standard deviation. That is the blue area and the green area. Okay, so if you want to also accommodate those results, okay, and have a better confidence in your results, then you should also consider two standard deviations. This is sigma, this is a mu plus two standard deviation and mu minus two standard deviation. If you want to be almost 99% sure, then what you have to do is you have to also consider the plus and minus three sigma. So this is normal distribution. Let us see what are the characteristics of normal distribution. Normal distribution is a symmetric curve. It gives you a symmetric curve, and the area under the curve is supposed to be 100%. And also that it is completely described by mean, that is mu, and standard deviation, that is sigma. Now let us quickly go to this table. Here I have introduced you two new words to you: confidence level and coverage factor. Now this is nothing but what we saw in this earlier graph. It's the same thing, just in some other words. Okay, so coverage factor is nothing but your standard deviation. So when I say that it's one standard deviation, you remember we saw one standard deviation, the pink area, it is 68.27%. Okay, when I say it is two standard deviation, it is 95.45% area under the curve. So almost 95.45% of your results will fall under plus minus two sigma standard deviation. Okay, and same way for three standard deviation. Okay, now comes the tricky part, rectangular distribution. Here please pay attention. I do not have any fancy slides nor any fancy videos, because the subject is really very, very technical. It's a dry subject, and I have tried my best to explain it to you with just words and numbers. Let us hope that it works. Okay, so rectangular distribution, so when you know that the true value is somewhere in the range, okay, rectangular distribution is used. Okay, I'll explain what that is. So basically, this distribution is a function that represents a continuous uniform distribution and constant probability. Okay, therefore in a rectangular distribution, all outcomes are equally likely to occur. Okay, so for example, let us take this a certificate of analysis of a particular CRM. Okay, and the manufacturer says that the concentration of the calibration standard is 1000 ppm. Okay, plus minus 2 ppm. It means that the concentration of the calibration standard can be anywhere from 998 ppm to 1002 ppm. But the manufacturer is not really sure where exactly it is. So therefore, conveniently, it is just said that it is plus minus 2 ppm. Or other example is the cadmium that I have given here. So when this is the case that you are not really sure where your true value lies, you would probably use the rectangular distribution. Okay, and when you want to find out the uncertainty, u is the uncertainty. So when you find out, when you want to find out the uncertainty due to rectangular distribution, this is the formula used. Okay, so a upon square root of 3. So basically you divide the function by square root of 3, that will give you uncertainty. Okay, this is a little tricky part, I understand. Probably when we see the example it will be more clear to you. Okay, so let us go to the next distribution, which is the triangular distribution. It is also very similar to a rectangular, there is a small difference. Okay, the available information concerning the true value, okay, in case of triangular distribution, okay, is less limited. Okay, so basically values close to x are more likely than the near bounds. Like for example, when we said in the earlier example that it could be anywhere between 998 to 1002, that is rectangular distribution. But if you say that, if the manufacturer says that he is sure that it is close to 1000 ppm, then that would also become a triangular distribution. Okay, so for example, let us take this example, like a 10 ml flask, volumetric flask. Okay, you have a COA of the 10 ml volumetric flask, and it says that the capacity is 10 ml plus minus 2. Okay, but you also find out in house, okay, that what is the volume of this particular flask, and you find that, okay, you have done multiple experiments in house to check what is the volume, and you find that the extreme values, that is values it is 10 plus minus 0.2, so it will be 9.8 to 10.2. so you will find out in your in house checks that the values which are at the extremes, that is at 9.8 and 10.2, are very less likely. Most of the values, if you find that during your experiments most of the values are very close to 10, you can still use the you can use the triangular distribution. There is a mistake here, I have written in such case a distribution can be considered as a rectangle, it is not, it is actually triangular. Okay, so when you are very sure that the value that you are looking at is very close to 10 ml, then you can use a triangular distribution. Okay, sources of uncertainty. Now we've seen that basically errors are responsible for uncertainties. Okay, and so we will just quickly see what are the different sources. The first important parameter is the ambiguity in defining the quantity. Okay, this is a very, very important aspect. For example, if you want to test vitamin A, you have to be very clear, how are you defining vitamin A? Are you saying that vitamin A is retinol? Are you saying it is vitamin A is retinol acetate or palmitate? Okay, so if you do not define the parameter correctly, okay, there will be ambiguity in the result. The next is the sampling. We all know that sampling is a very important aspect of the entire testing, and almost 50% of the uncertainties that arise in the testing are actually due to sampling. Okay, but sampling is not the focus today, so we will not be discussing this, but it does contribute a lot to the uncertainty. The next is the matrix effect and the interferences, which arise of course from the method. Then there are instrument effects, then there are reference material and reagent purities that could be a reason for uncertainty. Then there are environmental conditions, temperature, humidity, whatever. Then there is mass and volumetric equipment that we use. Then there are reference values. Like for example, we use for estimation of protein, we say that you have to calculate the total nitrogen and then you multiply it by number. That's a reference value, or pi, 22.7. These are all reference values. Okay. And there could be uncertainty because these reference values, we only consider two digits or three digits of it, and we do not know exactly where is that coming from. So that could also introduce, there are a lot of constants used in the calculations. So that also could be a reason of uncertainty. The next is the computational effect. Computational effect meaning rounding off. Okay, somebody may write 1.432 as 1.432, and somebody else may write it as 1.43. So that does introduce a very small, but still there is an error which is introduced. So these are computational effects. Then there is of course random variation, which is out of your control. There could be other sources of uncertainties also, but for beginners and just for the understanding purpose, I think this is enough. Now there are what the various types of uncertainties, type A, type B. A lot of you would have already known that there are type A and type B uncertainties. Then there are standard uncertainty, there is standard uncertainty, relative, combined, and expanded uncertainty. Okay, so let us quickly see now what is type A. Now type A, most of the contribution, I have always heard people saying that we know uncertainty, most of the contribution comes from type A. Yes, it is true, most of the contribution to total uncertainty is actually from type A. So what is type A? Method of evaluation of uncertainty by the statistical analysis of a series of observations. That is what we did in chloride analysis. We took multiple readings, and whatever uncertainty we will obtain from that particular experiment, taking multiple readings, will be called as type A uncertainty. Okay, so that is because of the uncertainty that you obtain from doing multiple experiments, series of observations. That is type A. Then comes the type B. Now, method of evaluation of uncertainty by means other than the multiple observations. Okay, so contributions from volumetric glassware. Basically, when we say that we refer to COAs, okay, that is basically the type B uncertainty. And as far as the chemical testing is concerned, okay, the contribution from type B generally is low. Okay, so we have to basically see to it that type A is very, very robust. Okay, the method of evaluating type A uncertainty should be very robust. Now, just to give you a flavor of what exactly is type B, okay, just consider this scenario. On the left hand side, there is an ideal case scenario. Okay, so you think, okay, you are a chemist and you are weighing some CRM, certified reference material, and you are weighing it 10 milligram, and you think that, you believe that the purity of this CRM is 100%, okay, and you are making up the volume to 10 ml in a volumetric flask. So you believe that you have made a 1000 ppm solution. In reality, it may be so that the CRM, the balance that you are using to weigh the CRM, okay, instead of weighing 10 milligram, okay, you have actually only weighed 9.94 milligram because there is some small error, okay, in the balance, in the linearity of the balance. Okay, the CRM that you are using actually is just 99.1% pure, not 100% pure. And the volume, volumetric flask that you are using, okay, is actually just 9.93 ml, has the capacity only of 9.93 ml. So instead of generating a 1000 ppm solution, you have generated 991.998 ppm solution. Now imagine this solution being used in the calculation somewhere. This error also will be carried forward. Okay, so this is just a small example to tell you that how the type B uncertainty also is important. Now comes the standard uncertainty. This is nothing but type A basically. So this is the uncertainty of the result expressed as a standard deviation. So what we did in type 1 or type A is the same thing. We took multiple readings, we found out standard deviation, and from standard deviation we calculate standard uncertainty. So this is standard uncertainty. Now how we do it is that there is a formula for that. So suppose you have a volumetric flask of 100 ml, okay, and you repeatedly weigh 100 ml in that volumetric flask and note down the weight and whatever, and then you find out the standard deviation. The formula for standard uncertainty of the volumetric flask is equal to standard deviation of the measurement divided by square root of n. This n is nothing but number of observations. So if you have taken 10 observations, you will write 10. If it is 20, it is 20. Okay. Then comes the relative uncertainty. Relative uncertainty, as the term suggests, it is just relative. Okay. So now that you have found out the uncertainty of the volumetric flask, okay, you divide it by the volume of the flask. So standard uncertainty of the flask divided by 100 ml. So while actually I should have shown you that this particular standard uncertainty of the volumetric flask does have a unit. It will have a unit of ml, okay, and this also has a unit of ml. So when you take relative uncertainty, the relative uncertainty will have no unit. It is a unitless quantity. The next is combined uncertainty. We will not take much time on that because it's, as the name suggests, it is just combining all the uncertainties, type A, type B, okay, and the formula for this is square root of type A square plus type B square. Now type B square, you may have multiple factors contributing to type A. It could be volume, it could be balance, it could be CRM. All those have to be squared up and then added to type A square, and then the entire thing has to be put under a square. So basically take a square root of all that. Okay. Then comes the expanded uncertainty. It provides an interval within which the value of the measurement is believed to be with a high level of confidence. Now expanded uncertainty is equal to combined uncertainty into coverage factor. Okay. Coverage factor, you remember, it is nothing but standard deviation, 1 sigma, 2 sigma and 3 sigma. Okay. So how do you calculate what is the procedure? Quickly we will see. First we have to write down the procedure, then write down the formula, then identify the sources by a fishbone diagram, and then calculate the type A, type B, combined and expanded uncertainty. Let us take this example of standardization of NaOH solution. Okay, I have explicitly referred to EuroChem guideline third edition. You will find these examples there. Okay, I have referred to those examples only. The first example is standardization of NaOH solution. NaOH is standardized against KHP, which is potassium hydrogen phthalate, and it's a titrimetry method. So this is the formula, okay, wherein we have to consider the molar mass of KHP, purity of KHP, mass of KHP, and volume of the titration. This is the fishbone diagram. So purity is what we will be considering. So in fishbone diagram basically tells you what are the sources of uncertainties. So we have found out for ourselves that repeatability, yes, that's the number one. Then there could be mass. Mass meaning balance, basically. Purity, then molar mass and volume. Okay, these are the different sources. Now, so what we do is now we analyze or we titrate NaOH with KHP multiple times. Okay, a lot of labs I have seen that they actually just make one solution and just titrate 5 times. That's not the right way or the correct way of doing uncertainty. What you have to do is you have to make 5 different solutions and you have to entirely conduct 5 different experiments. Okay, and let us assume that we arrive at this calculation. So average is 0.1 mole per liter. We find out the standard deviation and then we find out the standard uncertainty. We've already seen the formula for standard uncertainty, which is standard deviation divided by root n. I mean, in this case, root n is nothing but root 5 because we have taken 5 observations. Okay. So this is it. This is what it is. Okay. So our standard uncertainty is 000565. Now we move on to type B. Now type B, we have balance because we are weighing something. Okay, so let us assume that we've weighed 0.388 grams of KHP on the balance. Okay, and the balance is accompanied with a certificate from the manufacturer saying that the linearity of the balance is 0.15 milligram. We convert it to gram, okay, and we express everything in terms of gram in this case. Okay, so what we are doing here is that uncertainty due to balance. Okay, now here comes the rectangular and triangular distribution funda. Okay, so we do not know anything about how that linearity confidence interval is. The manufacturer has not said anything about that. So when we are in doubt, we always consider rectangular distribution. Okay, so what we have to do is we have to just divide the linearity, which is the source of uncertainty, by square root of 3. That's the definition of rectangular uncertainty. Okay, that's why we divide it by square root of 3. We can also divide it by square root of 6. But what happens is that the result that you get when you divide it by root 3 and root 6, okay, the result of root 6, okay, is lesser. Okay, and therefore you end up getting lesser uncertainty. Okay, so this is to avoid any confusion. It is better to have a little more uncertainty. Okay, that is why we always have to consider rectangular distribution when you are in doubt. Now this distribution is considered 2 times because one for tear and one for final weight. So that is how we do it. This is the uncertainty that we've obtained. Okay, 000886. So we multiply it by 2. Okay, and we have seen that in the combined uncertainty formula, we have seen that we have to always take a square of the uncertainty. So this is what we have done. We have taken a square, and because it's a 2-time activity, we have multiplied it by 2. So this is what we get. Uncertainty due to balance. Next is the purity of KHP. Now the certificate of KHP says that it is 1 plus minus 0005. That's the purity. So it means that the there is some uncertainty, 0005. Okay, and so basically 0.5%. And the manufacturer has not said anything about the distribution. Okay, so we assume rectangular distribution. Okay, so what we do is we take the purity. It is 0.05%. So you have to convert that percent to one figure, which is 0.05 upon 100. So you will do 0005 divided by square root of 3. This will give you the uncertainty due to purity of catch B. Okay, this is what I have mentioned here. In case of non-availability of information, it is better to use rectangular distribution as it gives higher uncertainties than the triangular distribution. The next contribution is from the molar mass of KHP. Why I have taken molar mass? Because it is present in the formula. Okay, so whatever is present in the formula, you have to take those contributions without fail. Okay, so molar mass of KHP is the next one. So this table is available actually on the internet. You can find it in the IUPAC website. And element wise atomic weights, what we're doing in a molar mass is actually we are adding up the atomic weights of individual atom. So this is what we are doing it. But when we say carbon is 8, carbon is 12, the molecule, the atomic weight may not be actually 12. There is some uncertainty in the atomic weight. So that also has to be considered. So how have we considered that? So carbon has an atomic weight of 12.0107 and the quoted uncertainty is plus minus 0.0008. Okay, so it can range anywhere between this 0.0008. Therefore, we are not sure. So we use rectangular distribution. So what we do is we take this quoted uncertainty 0.0008 and divide it by root 3. That will give you uncertainty per atom. This is just for one atom. But there are 8 carbon atoms in the formula of KHP. Therefore, you multiply this 0.00462 by 8. That will give you the uncertainty for all carbon atoms in the formula. Likewise, we do it for hydrogen, oxygen, and potassium. And then on the right and extreme right hand side, we have all the uncertainties due to all the atoms. Now, total uncertainty in the molar mass of KHP. So this is again nothing but a kind of a combined uncertainty. Okay, so when it is combined uncertainty, I've already told you, you have to square the contribution from each element. So you every element you have uncertainty written here. So you will just double square them up and add them up. Okay, so that will give you the uncertainty of KHP molecular weight. Okay, then comes the volumetric glassware. This is a very important aspect, and we use a lot of volumetric glassware in the lab. So basically, volumetric glassware has two types of uncertainties: contributions from calibration and contribution from the thermal expansion. Okay, thermal expansion is of glassware and it is of water as well, but the thermal expansion of glassware is very negligible and therefore we can actually not consider it. It is okay, but the other two contributions have to be considered. Now, a burette of 20 ml, let us imagine for this KHP NaOH experiment, we use a burette of 20 ml. Okay, now as per the COA burette, has a capacity of 20 plus minus 0.03 ml. Okay, but there is no mention of coverage factor, confidence level, etc. We have no other information. So we use rectangular distribution. We assume rectangular distribution. Okay, so we just take this plus minus 0.03, which is the uncertainty, and divide it by square root of 3. That will give us the uncertainty due to calibration of burette. Okay, this has a unit of ml. Okay, next comes the thermal expansion coefficient of water. Okay, water expands, we are aware, right? So the thermal expansion, thermal coefficient of expansion of water is 2.1 into 10 raised to minus 4 per degree Celsius. And what we have to do is that we know that the volumetric glassware is calibrated at a particular temperature. That temperature is written on the volumetric glassware also. But it is not possible to maintain the same temperature everywhere, every time in all the labs. So generally what we do is that we consider this contribution of uncertainty using the following formula. So what we do is that we multiply the variation in the lab. Okay, if it is plus minus 3 degrees Celsius. Okay, so basically it may range from 21 to say 26. So all the range has to be covered. And therefore, it is plus minus 3 degrees Celsius. So you multiply the coefficient of expansion of water by 3. If the variation is 5 degree, you will have to multiply it by 5. And into the volume of the glassware that is under consideration. So here it is 20 ml burette. If there is a 1000 ml flask, you will have to consider 1000 ml. Okay. So that will give you the uncertainty, which is now in this case, it is 0.0126 ml is the deviation or the error in the volume that will be delivered, and that has to be divided by the square root of 3. That will give you the uncertainty because of volumetric expansion. Okay, now we have the volumetric expansion 0.0727, and in the earlier slide we had calibration uncertainty, which is 0.1732. So we combine them again, a type of combined uncertainty. So we square the individual uncertainties 0.0727 and 0.1732, and that's how we get the total uncertainty due to volume of the burette only. If in case you are using any other glassware in the experiment, say a pipette or anything else, you may also consider the uncertainty arising from those glassware. You will have to add them separately. Okay, so now we are done with all the uncertainty sources. Now let us just summarize. Okay, so this is typically in the EuroChem guideline, it's called budget. Okay, so this is the budget of the NIOH standardization. On the left hand side, we can see the contributors of uncertainties, mass, purity, molar mass, etc. And then you see the value. Okay, and then you see the standard uncertainty, and then you see the relative uncertainty. Now you can see that for the relative uncertainty, I have written U upon X, that is standard uncertainty divided by X. Why I have done this? Because these all are different sources, they have different units. Okay, and we just saw that combined uncertainty formula, okay, wants us to add all these quantities. So if the units of all these quantities, you cannot add a banana and an apple. Okay, they all have to be categorized under fruit, only then you can add them up. So it's the same thing here. So what you are doing here is generally you are converting all of them to a quantity which has no unit, and then you are able to add them up. That's a very simple logic. So what we have done here is that we have just added those quantities. We have first made them unitless, and then we have squared them, because that's what the uncertainty, combined uncertainty formula says. So what we have done is we have just added all the uncertainties. You can see all the uncertainties here. Okay, can I use this is drawing tool. How can I show Kavita? Just wanted to show anyway. So we have added all the uncertainty sources. Okay, here, and here is our combined uncertainty, which is 0.0058 moles per liter. Okay, now this is just combined uncertainty. Okay, we also have to find out expanded uncertainty. Again, going back to the basics, why we need expanded uncertainty? Because what experiment we've done is only taking repeated experiments. We have taken 5 repeated experiments. We have found out a standard deviation, which is just 1 standard deviation. So the result that we got here, combined uncertainty, it is just from 1 standard deviation. It is just about 68% of our results. Okay, so there could be some results which are beyond this, and if you want to be sure about your experiment, then you will have to consider a higher confidence level of 95%. But for that, you will have to consider the second, the 2 sigma level as well. So what we do in expanded uncertainties, we multiply the combined uncertainty obtained with the coverage factor. That is just to compensate, okay, for the other results which are outside 1 sigma, plus minus 1 sigma. Okay, so that is what we do. Now we've said that we will use a coverage factor, okay, and there are coverage factors also written here. Okay, but there is one problem here is that if the number of observations, okay, that you are taking are less than 6, okay, generally you should derive the effective degrees of freedom, and based on those effective degrees of freedom, you have to find out the coverage factor from student's t table. I know it's a lot of confusion here, so let us go stepwise. First, let me tell you that if you are taking a lot of experiments, you're doing a lot of experiments, number of observations are around 10, okay, in that case you can directly use coverage factor of 2. And you can say that at 95% confidence level, these are my results. So you can multiply the combined uncertainty directly with a factor of 2 if the number of observations that you have taken are more than 10 or 10. Okay. But if they're not 10, they're less than 6. In fact, like in our case, we just made 5 readings. So we cannot directly use the coverage factor as 2. We have to find out what is the coverage factor. For that, there is a formula. Okay, it is getting complex, I know, but that's the way it works. So we come to this formula called a Wells-Satterwhite formula or equation. Okay, this is used to find out the effective degrees of freedom. So now we are introducing another concept of effective degrees of freedom. What is degrees of freedom? We'll come to that. Let us see the formula first. This is the formula. Okay, you can see that it is V effective is equal to UC raised to 4. UC is nothing but combined uncertainty divided by summation of UI raised to 4 upon VI raised to 4. Okay, this is actually a very, very simplified formula for you. The original formula, if you see, it's not the same way. It is a different formula. Okay, it has some additional terms, and I have removed those terms for easy understanding of you. Now, what are those terms also? I will tell you. The original expression is like this. V effective is equal to UC raised to 4 divided by summation of UI CI raised to 4. UI raised to 4, CI raised to 4 upon VI plus, this is just type A. Likewise, you have to add up all the uncertainties because of type B sources as well. Okay, so it will be UI raised to 4, CI raised to 4 for type A plus UI raised to 4, CI raised to 4 upon effective degree upon degrees of freedom for type B. But what happens is that it is said that in the type B case, okay, the degrees of freedom for type B sources is generally considered to be infinity. Okay, so now we have this degree of freedom in the denominator. Okay, so if the denominator has infinity, okay, it makes no sense. So therefore, for type B, I have removed that type B term. Okay, now let us come to CI. The original formula, I said it is UI raised to 4, CI raised to 4. What is this CI? It is nothing but a sensitivity coefficient, and generally it is supposed to be 1. Okay, let us not go into the details of why it is 1 and what. It is just remember that it is this formula, UC raised to 4 upon UI raised to 4 upon degrees of freedom is what you have to use for day-to-day calculations. Okay, so this is the formula, and so what is the degree of freedom? What is this degree of freedom? This is again a concept that you need to understand. Okay, degree of freedom is equal to number of independent observations minus number of parameters estimated. Okay, for example, income of n number of people in a community is recorded. Okay, so here n number of people. Okay, so n is equal to independent pieces of information, and the parameter that we are studying is income. Like in our case, we have the chloride analysis, okay, from multiple chemists. So we are measuring only one parameter, which is chloride. Okay, therefore effective degree, therefore degrees of freedom is equal to just one parameter. Therefore the parameter is only one. But tomorrow, if you say that you will also analyze conductivity along with chloride, okay, then the parameters that you are measuring becomes two, and therefore instead of subtracting one, you will subtract two. Okay, I know it's a little difficult to understand, but just please keep this in mind that degree of freedom is equal to number of independent observations. Okay, which is in our case, this sodium hydroxide experiment, it was 5. And we were just seeing the concentration. Therefore, it was just one parameter which we were estimating. And therefore, it is 5 minus 1, which is equal to 4. Okay, now we again go back to our NaOH experiment. Okay, and we said that we only took 5 readings, which were not sufficient, and therefore we cannot directly use a coverage factor of 2. So we have to find out the effective degrees of freedom from this complex equation, which we have done. And it turns out that it is 4.3. So approximately we can say the effective degrees of freedom for our NaOH experiment are 4. Now what we have to do is we have to see to the student C table. Again, a new concept. I know it's a little difficult, but let us see what is student T table. Okay, what is student T table? This is the student T table. Okay, it's a very, very long table, and you cannot see it probably also on this screen. but it is available on the net and you can certainly refer to the internet later on. But let me tell you what is the student tea table. So what happens is that a lot of times we do not have the time and money to measure the every single sample from a batch. If I'm a producer and I want to export some 10 tons of sample, I will not analyze the entire 10 tons. I'll just take out some random 10, 15 samples and get it analyzed. And based on those results, I will decide the future of that 10 tons. Okay. So because it is not practical to analyze everything. So therefore we take out a small sample and we analyze it. Okay. Now the standard deviation, okay, of that small sample that we analyze, small sample data that we analyze, it does not necessarily tell you, okay, anything useful about how widely the larger group's values vary around their average. We've just analyzed 10 samples from a 10 ton batch. Okay, we do not know how the 10 ton batch will have what will be the standard deviation. Okay, for the 10 ton batch. Okay, so there is some small compensation or maybe a big compensation that we will have to consider beforehand. Okay, so that is what we do when we use the student tea table. Okay, so student tea value is a random variable that uses the standard deviation of the small sample to help determine average of the larger group it represents. Okay, so we want to compensate. We want to be sure that because we are dealing with a 10 ton batch on the basis of just 10 samples, we don't want to make any underestimation of the deviation. And therefore, we are compensating that by using a coverage factor. Okay. So now we have to refer to the student tea table. So now, if you see degrees of freedom on the extreme left, if you go to number 4, okay, and on the same corresponding level, please check with 95%. The factor here is 2.78. Okay, so in our case, NIOH experiment, we cannot multiply the combined uncertainty with 2. We have to multiply it with 2.78. Okay, so we do this. Okay, so our effective degrees of freedom, we found out the coverage factor, and then we have multiplied that with the combined uncertainty, and now our uncertainty is 0.0016 moles per liter. So the result, how do we express the result, is that the concentration of NaOH, we found out 5 repeated experiments and it is 0.1008, and the uncertainty is always expressed as a range. So this will be plus minus 0.0016 moles per liter. And we have to write down what is the confidence level and the coverage factor. So there is a mistake, the coverage factor should have been 2.78. Okay, so that's how you represent the final result. Now, this is just a recap because a lot of things are set currently. Okay, so just a recap, first carry out the replicate measurements, preferably 10. Okay, certainly not 2 or 3. Then calculate the standard deviation of your result. Okay, then the standard uncertainty. How do you calculate standard uncertainty? Standard deviation divided by root 10, that is number of observations. The third is find out type B sources. Okay, then find out contribution of these sources and express them as standard uncertainties. Okay, so we did this experiment wherein we divided linearity by root 3, we divided purity by root 3, you know, things like that. So that is type B uncertainty sources. Then add all of these sources to calculate combined uncertainties. Then find out the effective degrees of freedom. Okay, if number of observations are less than 6, then you have to go to effective degrees of freedom formula, find out the corresponding coverage factor from the student tea table. And then once you do that, you calculate the expanded uncertainty by multiplying the coverage factor and combined uncertainty. Okay, so that will tell you, that will give you the final answer. Again, I have made some useful tips. Kavita, are we running out of time? Can we extend? Because a few more slides here. Kavita?
Yes.
Tips for the beginners. Okay. So what you need to do when you want to find out uncertainty of any parameter, chemical parameter. Okay. This is it. This is what you have to do. Write down the steps of the test method and the formula. Formula is very important. Okay. The next is consider only those contributions which are mentioned in the formula. Okay, a lot of people I have seen, they use oven temperature, okay, oven calibration, thermometer calibration as a source of uncertainty. Yes, I agree, it's a source of uncertainty, but it is an indirect source. Okay, if the oven temperature is not up to the mark, it will finally show up in your weight. Okay, if you are particularly, if you are considering the ashing equipment, ashing exercise, if the oven temperature is not correct, the variation that you get in the final result of ash, okay, that will have that error already incorporated in it. Therefore, don't make the things complex. Do not take anything which is not mentioned in the formula. Simple as that. The next is concentrate more on the type A uncertainty. Okay, try doing experiments for type A, multiple experiments. Also, to get a realistic type A uncertainty, collect data from different chemists and on different days. Okay, but remember the test method should be same. Okay, because